Okay, just to start then, we'll just start by clarifying some terms just so that we're all on exactly the same page with these terms, and also to try and pick out some contingencies later on. So often when the term neoliberalism is used, it's thought of in terms of an event after Keynesian demand management, interventionism, and a turn to free markets. So for example, public choice theory would talk about Keynesian demand management in terms of the failure of politics, how political interventionism failed, and now we need to turn to a science of markets. Okay, so neoliberalism is now about turning from state interventionism and the failure of politics to markets, which can get it right if left to their own devices. However, it's more accurate to think in terms of neoliberalism and ordoliberalism being terms that and ideas that came into being after World War II with a need to reinvent liberalism. So I was going to talk about ordoliberalism and contrast it with neoliberalism. I just did the conceptual clarification bit. So post-World War II, how do we reinvent liberalism? Ordoliberalism was very much concerned with free markets. So the state would actually have to intervene to construct the conditions for the markets. Market is recognised that markets don't sort of bootstrap or self-generate from human nature. You know, as long as you just bulldoze the state out of the way, automatically you get not Lord of the Flies, but happy little township high streets of people buying and selling freely and equally. Right, so the state would need to construct a market. Once that had happened, the price mechanism should transmit quality, right? So you should be able to have faith in the price mechanism in a market operating freely, that the price would mirror the quality of the product, right? As mediated through customer choice. Customers wouldn't pay a high price for a poor quality product. That was really the German approach to liberalism. The American approach, based in the Chicago School of Law and Economics, also recognized the state would need to build markets. And there are some ambivalence about corporations, but ultimately they shifted from seeing corporations as being relatively benign to being quite positive. So they were not too worried about markets being dominated by corporations. Right? They still believed that market efficiency should undermine inefficient market actors, but someone dominating a market was seen to be a consequence of market efficiency. So corporations were seen to be the most efficient and able market actors. And the fact that they were funded by the Volcker Fund, which was paid for by corporations, had nothing, obviously, to do with that. So the Volcker Fund thought we need to build up a strong resistance to state socialism, and that means having strong capitalism. Having strong capitalism doesn't mean having a myriad of little high streets with rational choice consumers and small businesses. It means having powerful actors, and corporations were the business, bad pun. They were the key market, most efficient market actors, right? What about the price mechanism? Well, price mechanism was not seen to be of too much importance. It wasn't as important as, you know, the ordo-liberals saw it. The price mechanism could be distorted. That wasn't the most worrying thing. The most important thing was to have corporations operating efficiently. And Murawski's done really good history on the development of neoliberalism. I'm homogenizing it a bit. There were lots of internal spats because they're academics, but ultimately that was the consensus they arrived at. There's been some really good work later on by Will Davies and Wendy Brown, drawing on Foucault, to talk about how neoliberalism recognised that people weren't sort of homo economicus. They would need to be nudged and cajoled, encouraged into market behaviours. So neoliberalism was not just a project to manufacture markets, guard particular types of markets, which would mean ultimately being in favour of corporations, but to create a market rationality too, to create policies to nudge and influence people to thinking in terms of market rationality and how this became ubiquitous. So Wendy Brown talks about how everything in life, from actual consumption. So it's like online dating is seen in terms of a market. We can go a stage further than that, which is what I'll be talking about this afternoon, which is not just about market rationality, that people should see things in terms of acquisition for self-advancement, but the right type of market rationality. So people are buying the right products. So when it gets to education, one of the problems is there's lots of talk about the free market and the student as customer, but really, without wanting to go into the territories of conspiracy theory, it's fairly obvious that positioning the student as a customer, it was hoped they would sort of move away from things like philosophy and sociology and stuff that wasn't too practical. So in the shift that I'm talking about, there's an attempt to say, well, look, you know, you've been buying products, but you haven't been quite buying the right products. So these are actually the right products. And the TEF, the green paper, will be trying to sort of nudge, cajole, or shove people in the right direction to buy the right products. And being a bit bleak, perhaps, if you want to buy the wrong product, like sociology or philosophy, it might not still be around, so it might not have that customer choice, but that's at least the government looking out for you as a customer by making sure you don't invest in the wrong type of non-capital. Right. Now to say a quick word or two about interventionism. Often the debate gets set up in terms of Keynesian demand management intervention, that's corporatist, collectivist, and now free markets, and we can talk about the problems of those supposed free markets. I think that's problematic conceptually and like rhetorically, empirically. Start with the latter first. It puts you on a bit of a back foot if you want to argue with, say, non-social science people, because immediately it's set up in terms of wanting to invade someone's freedom. So it's like interventionism, non-interventionism. Why are you trying to justify more government interventionism? Conceptually, governments are always interventionist. So when you've shifted from demand management with Keynesianism to supply-side policies to free up capital and free up labour, they can be just as interventionist. But rather than be corporatist interventionist policies, they are interventionist policies in pursuit of perceived elite interests. So it's not so much deregulation as re-regulation. So TTIP, for example, if that went through, wouldn't be a bonfire of the regulations. It would just be changing regulations to help corporations. Right? Regulation of unions wasn't simply reducing legislation, it was actually changing legislation against unions. And more substantively, how the state gets involved, intervening in life, you could look at things like drugs. Right? Originally, richer white people taking morphine and cocaine, not a problem. Then the state realises we will associate drugs with outsider communities. That legislates heavy interventionism against those communities. And where you end up a few decades later is the prison industrial complex, supposedly free market society, right? So state and private capital in bed together, turning people into commodities and pumping them through the prison industrial complex. Something a bit similar here with Prevent and all the millions spent on Project Champion, putting up all the cameras around Birmingham. So interventionism can be a neoliberal project, and it's not necessarily something that's only associated with Keynesianism. Right? States are always intervening, it's intervening in elite interests. It's not simply the return to the night watchman state. Finally, on the conceptual clarification bit before I get to government policy, audit culture can be a strong form of government interventionism in the public sector. So it tries to create a market by making you consume between different providers, looking at the statistics on the different units, schools for example, to see in the market which one might be better than the other. It positions the citizen as a consumer. You're not part of a community wanting all the services to be good, you're thinking in terms of self-interest. Democracy is in terms not so much of voting, but in terms of realising yourself through consumption. It's trying to reposition you as a consumer. In the political sphere. And finally, there's the belief that left to their own devices, professionals are not motivated by a love of their profession or a vocation, but they are basically slackers. And if things are opaque, And if there's not someone peering down on them, then they will just game the system. They'll be lazy and tardy and not provide the customer, rather than the person they're dealing with in the professional relationship, with the best possible service. So by having audit culture, great markets, you can position the citizen as a consumer, and you can make sure professionals get off their arse to work efficiently rather than being tardy. Because without that beam of audit light on them, it's assumed they'll just be pursuing vested self-interest and not being that helpful to people. Well, that last point, one negative consequence is, to state the obvious, you get perverse incentives to game the system. So one example of that would be in healthcare, where you had the Liverpool care pathway for people dying. All the audit data showed that things were going well because you had a tick box culture where people were incentivized to make sure that they did everything, they jumped all the hoops they needed to tick all the boxes. So on paper, it looked like the professionals were doing what they were meant to do, delivering the customer service. And the result was people didn't receive the palliative care and had problems and died quite uncomfortable deaths because they did not receive the professional care they needed, because they were so busy doing everything, fully incentivized to do everything to tick boxes and make it look like they were jumping through audit hoops, which they were, but they weren't actually doing the professional service. So it guts actually the vocationalism and professionalism out of things to make it look like you are being the efficient worker. So that's the conceptual clarification bit on neoliberalism, interventionism, and audit culture. Audit culture can be a strong form of interventionism in pursuit of the interests. So now I want to talk about higher education policy and split that into two phases, basically before and after the Green Paper that came out in November last year. So in the first phase, I'd say it was a sort of quasi-ordo-liberal phase, sort of different contingencies playing out. Then after the publication of the Green Paper in November last year, it was a more strongly, more assertive, more aggressive neoliberal agenda, with audit culture playing a strong role in that. So key features of phase one would be obviously 1998, New Labour bring in fees, so starting to position the student as the customer, albeit in a very heavily constrained and capped market. Next, 2005, introduction of the National Student Survey. Interestingly, Hefke Report 01/66, you can memorise these data, right? Hefke Report 0166 states that the NSS is not to be used comparatively within an institution, let alone between institutions. The NSS is only to be used to see if customers are happy with the product they've bought, and if they're not, to see how it can be changed according to its own terms of reference. But it cannot be, the data cannot be transported and used in a comparative way within an institution, let alone between institutions. And obviously, what's happened is that now all the league tables go straight to NSS data, and managers are always talking about NSS. And if people get a low NSS, there's the danger of departments closing. So originally it said the NSS, this wasn't critics of the NSS, this was Hefke. Hefke, this is not a comparative tool, it's not designed to be used in that way. And now its primary use is as a comparative tool for people positioned as customers to make a consumption choice, even though it wasn't designed for that, it's not fit for that purpose. Could it be used in a quasi-ordo-liberal way, with satisfaction being used as a proxy for the price mechanism? Would it be the case that if different degrees have high levels of customer satisfaction, or be in a capped market, then you can say this is a proxy to the price mechanism, and therefore I know that if I invest my human capital in that course where other customers have had high satisfaction, that will be okay. I can trust in that data and trust that I'm making the right consumption choice. In the same way, I can trust that people would only buy things that were worth something. I think that's how it's become used, quasi-ordo-liberal way, but I think there are a number of problems with that. There's a report, this article by Cheng and Marsh, 2010, which said that the difference between HEIs, between universities, was not statistically significant. So at an aggregate macro level, the NSS doesn't really tell you that one provider, one institution, is better than another. Some recent research on medical students, so there's no correlation between NSS scores and degree quality as measured by degree grades. There's also been research to show that student feedback can be influenced by things like sexism and classism too. It's definitely not a neutral tool. On that note, it can introduce perverse incentives to game the system. Someone who gives lower marks might undermine the NSS, so there might be an incentive to give higher marks. And it's just coincidence, of course, that the number of people getting two ones and firsts over the last decade has gone up quite a bit. And there have been numbers of cases in the press, including one, I think it was at Kingston, where people were told, if you give us a poor NSS, then employers will see that, think your degree is worthless, and you will suffer. Right? So there's a strong incentive to perverse incentive to game the system with the NSS, which undermines it, of course. Another point to consider is that audit data can never, ever, no matter how accurate it is, if it ever is, generate trust. Trust and confidence are two different things. Audit data is actually premised on a lack of trust, because you wouldn't say, I trust my friend or partner because I've put a camera on them and I've just been seeing everything they're doing to make their life transparent. Therefore, by rendering it transparent, I know they're not being a tardy partner, not going out buying me something. So therefore, I can see they've been performing well and I trust them now, whereas before that you don't, right? Audit data is built up with there being no trust. I don't trust you, therefore I'm going to create a whole bunch of numbers to measure everything you're doing so I can make an inference about whether you're shifty or reliable or not. And finally, you might want to consider whether dissatisfaction is the most useful type of education. So Stephen Collini, in his book, What Are Universities For? And Mary Beard have also said the point of education really is to create dissatisfaction. It's to move people out of their comfort zones. So rather than spoon-feeding people, getting them to jump through hoops with model answers, it's about trying to get people to think and challenge their prejudices. Their key ideas, the ideas they come to university with, to rethink how perhaps they see and feel the world, which is an uncomfortable experience, right? They might keep their original ideas, but at least they would have had them challenged. But the point is, it should be an unsettling, dissatisfying experience where you reflect deeply on yourself and challenge your core ideas and core assumptions. So on that basis, dissatisfaction, not satisfaction, should be the real goal. And that, like trust, can't be measured because it is something that's more empathetic, more subjective, more qualitative. You can't really say on a scale of 1 to 5, I've had my fundamental existential assumptions challenged with something like that, and then managers pat you on the head for challenging their fundamental existential assumptions, providing they don't criticise management. Yeah. So that's the NSS. Like, wasn't meant to be used in a quasi-ordo-liberal way. It is. That was a contingent outcome. It was a pretty obvious outcome. If you give people, institutions that start to operate in a competitive way, data where they can use that to compete with each other, they will. Yeah. One more comment on that is that Scotland was exempt from the NSS, but most Scottish institutions chose voluntarily to engage with the NSS because they thought this will be useful. Why? Because it helps us show that we've got something better than the others. We've got nothing to hide. Going back to this idea that you've got tardy professionals, everyone's a slacker, providing you haven't got a beam of light on them, and therefore we can show that this data shows that we're better than any other competitor. So, in other words, it's fairly inevitable the NSS data would be used that way, even if Hefke stated it shouldn't. Finally, in phase one, we have the Brown Report, 2010. So the Brown Report recommended more ordo-liberal outcome, free market. The price mechanism should guarantee quality. There should be no cap on fees charged, and people will pay what the market bears. So the price mechanism will be the guarantor of quality in this market that we have constructed. One of the people put on the Brown Report is Sir Michael Barber. Sir Michael Barber was a consultant to New Labour and is now the chief education consultant at Pearson. In 2013, so a few years after Brown, he co-authored a report called An Avalanche Is Coming, and in that sort of made 3 points. First, university teaching needs to be unbundled. You can't have a one-size-fits-all policy where everyone is trying to do the same thing. So you can't have a city with three universities all trying to do physics, all trying to do sociology, all trying to do politics, all trying to do IR, right? That's an anachronistic model. Universities need to adapt to markets, and they need to provide the skill set that local employers need, right? They shouldn't try and divorce themselves from local skill, from local employers' needs. They need to unbundle their functions and focus on providing teaching skills that local employers need. When it comes to research, research should be for short-term economic gain. So he wasn't even saying that research should be in more technical science subjects that might be slow burners and have commercial applications 5 or 10 years from now. It was immediate short-term gain. Right? So again, academics should not be doing lots of work in the lab in theoretical physics. It should be set, the research should be set by the needs of business. It's very, very clear, short-term, immediate economic gain. Not science and technology as a slow burner, but immediate gain. And the third point is our old friend, the slacker professional, that there's a comment in there about academics have quite a nice, cushy life. That's all very well for them, but why should we fund that? They need to be jolly well more efficient, and by meeting employer needs through research and through teaching, they will be doing that. So we need to make them jump through the hoops a bit more to be meeting what the economy actually needs. You might have one or two people who can still get away with doing a book on poetry or philosophy or something like that and getting paid for it, but really they should be more efficient in meeting local business needs. That was a report that came out in 2013, but he was put on the Brown Report, not by accident, but he's put there because that's really trying to set the tone of the Brown Report. Obviously, political contingencies came into play, and what came out of that was a bodge with a £9,000 fee maximum, which inadvertently created a £9,000 fee norm against their expectations. So contingencies have a role here. And one problem that then comes on from that, that Leggettigan has talked a lot about, is the RAB charge, which is the resource accounting and budget data. The RAB charge basically means the amount of money that won't be paid back. And it's estimated that's just under 50% of student fees will not be repaid in full. So the RAB charge is quite high, which then means the government can't sell off the £9,000 loan book. So they have an incentive to try and bring down the fee. And at the moment they keep saying that the fee is too high, that Russell Group universities are a bunch of, back to our old friend again, slacker institutions, and we're not providing quality. So I think there's an emphasis to try and bring in for profits and reduce the fee down, including Russell Groups. I'll say more about that in a second. Right. So that's the sort of general tenor of things up until last year. Fees, NSS, and Brown. Brown, on paper, looks like it's ordo-liberal. You're free to choose whatever you want, providing the market will bear it. If people want to pay £20,000 a year for philosophy or sociology and the market bears that, fine. That's what it was on the surface, though I suspect underneath the assumption was if people are paying serious money, they will want to have economically useful human capital subjects, especially with Michael Barber's predilections, right? But on the surface, at least, it seemed to be more ordo-liberal. You pay whatever you want, providing the market will bear that. November last year, Green Paper comes out, Fulfilling Our Potential. That's going to be converted into a white paper, which will come out on the 18th of this month, and then John Homewood and others will then produce the alternative white paper, which has just been drafted. That idea came about from the Convention on Higher Education a few months ago. The Green Paper marks a fairly robust, stroke aggressive shift towards fully neoliberal approach to higher education. So it identifies some problems and the solutions. So the problems: economic productivity. The only way, they state, for the economy to grow will be to increase economic productivity. At the moment, the report laments, there are too many graduates who are underemployed and not enough STEM graduates, so there's a shortage of STEM graduates that will hold back productivity. So to boost productivity, and this is like on page one, it's right there, it's not hidden away in a footnote or something where you talk about academic values and then the stuff about economics is hidden in the background, it's right there in the front. Productivity is the issue. We need the right people doing the right degrees and with the right degrees to boost productivity, and that means getting people doing STEM subjects. Very clear about that, because the economy depends on it, and education is there for the economy. They want to increase BME participation in higher education by 20% by 2020. Equality. They say there's not a level playing field because at the moment private enterprise finds it hard to break into the higher education market because they have to be validated by existing universities. They might have a vested interest in not allowing that, so we need to try and level the playing field. And the final problem they associate, again, is with slacker professionals having a lack of teaching intensity, we don't teach enough, and there's grade inflation. Right? So we are failing to provide quality products and overinflating the grades. The government have started making quite a few noises about the need for more teaching intensity. So they keep saying that we need to have more and more teaching intensity, and are linking teaching quality to teaching intensity. This is something they're very much focusing on. We need to have more time teaching and stop being such slacker professionals. In other words, more training. The context in which this has come out is one where general mood music is more pro-STEM and anti-STEM comments coming out. STEM is science, technology, engineering, maths. So Nicky Morgan, Secretary of State for Education last year, said pupils that do not study STEM subjects but study humanities subjects are held back for life. That quote. If you do a humanities subject, you are held back for life. That coincided with the launch of something called Your Life, and Your Life is an industry-led initiative to get more school children into STEM subjects. But the government's backing it, so it's a government-backed private initiative to convince more school children to do STEM subjects, to invest in their future. And in the context of that, you've got Nicky Morgan's comment that humanities are basically a waste. That came out about the same time as the Green Paper. So their solutions then are to change regulation to make it easier for profits to start awarding degrees. They say that institutions with no incumbency interest, i.e. no students, i.e. corporations, should be able eventually to have DAPs, or degree awarding powers. So companies should be able to have their own degree awarding powers, and they can just select from, say, local providers, and if you give us the students we want, we continue to give you the degree awarding power. If you don't, we just switch to another company, right, to make sure we get the students we want. So to make it easier for for-profits to come into the market and even give companies their own degree awarding powers. Also want to introduce degree apprenticeships, where you spend 3 or 4 years doing your degree with a company, and the training you get then counts towards a degree. And obviously critical thinking will be a transferable skill that will be highly valued in those circumstances. Deregulation is one part. They also say that private companies, for-profit providers, will be better able to reach hard-to-reach communities. So they're hoping that the for-profit providers will be able to help them meet their target of 20% increase BME students by 2020. So they're hoping that they will be able to target those groups and boost their participation in higher education. So we can solve the equality issue by privatisation. We can stop the nasty quasi-public private public universities, which are just there for vested self-interest, keeping out the nice profit-making people, and as a consequence of that, holding down disadvantaged groups. And we can help private capital and help disadvantaged groups simultaneously by allowing for-profits to come into the market to target those disadvantaged groups. That's one part of the Green Paper's suggestion. The other part is the Teaching Excellence Framework. It's the TEF. TEF will have two components. On the one hand, there will be a panel made up of business interests or professional interests, student stroke customer representatives, and educational experts in that particular discipline. That may well mean a push towards a standardised curricula. The other part of the TEF will come from metrics. The metrics they will start with will be NSS data. So NSS data will be used comparatively, even though Hefke said it can't be used for that purpose. Now, it's not just the Guardian and the Times and university managers misusing it, it'd be the government's TEF scheme too. And employment data, the assumption being that you can measure quality of education in terms of types of job you get. Over time, that will change. You will have metrics on teacher training, because we need to be trained more. We can't rely on the professional using it as their vocation, we need to have formal training. Teaching intensity. In terms of the ref, if you can take the depression, there aren't any gags at the end either to line it up. In terms of the ref cost 246 million, 232 of that was borne by universities. That's bad. So we shift to metrics to save money. Derek Sayer has criticised the panel-based metrics by saying it's way too subjective. There's no way people are going to read two articles a day, every day, for a year. So he's argues for metrics too. But the problem with shifting to metrics in the humanities and social science is that's all about impact. Right? It becomes a big data project where you can measure impact by looking at an article's citations, or the impact factor of a journal on dashboards, which we talked about the last time, to look at an academic's real-time impact, your citations in that article have been going up. At a general level, that will hammer the social sciences and humanities because they have far lower impacts generally than natural sciences, except those subjects that deal with accepting neoliberal behaviours rather than those that challenge them. So economics and psychology might be okay, sociology won't be. One problem, I think, is that some sociologists have been trying to say, oh, but we can play the impact game too. So Campaign for Social Science produced something called The Business of People. So all those years of reading social science didn't go amiss. Basically said, we can take people and make sure we can mould them to adapt to neoliberal market realities rather than question those systematic realities. That's basically saying we can play catch up with economics, psychology. We can take market realities as given and make sure people can fit to those realities rather than changing those realities to fit what people actually need. And that was their argument for social science, right? So academics are being co-opted into this. But if it does go down the metrics line, that will be very negative. Peer review is problematic, but the metrics line will be very negative. The Stern Review is currently looking into this, and that's concluded taking in consultations in March, so that will be digesting them over the next few months. I'm not particularly optimistic about that. Is there any scope for hope? Government wanted to get rid of feminism and gender on A-level syllabus. There's pushback on that, which was successful. Warwick, its casualisation policy with Teach Higher, has pushback on that, was successful. The National Union of Students want to boycott the NSS and the destination data, which would mess up the TEF nicely. Not that I'm being neutral here. And there is scope for using neoliberalism against itself by to say, well, hang on a minute, you as the rational customer, you as the student customer, are not getting the deal you think you are. The TEF won't help you because it could be retrospectively changed. You won't get the choice you're thinking of getting, and STEM subjects might not be that useful. And I know computer science isn't a STEM subject, but by saying the highest unemployed graduates are in computer science, so going for an apparently vocational subject doesn't necessarily guarantee that success. There might be some scope to try and use neoliberal rhetoric against itself. Academics, the weak link in the chain, perhaps. I suspect academics will just try and keep their heads in the sand and hope it goes away, because not that many are doing much protesting about it at the moment, and at the Convention for Higher Education, only 80 people were there in London. So it might be the case that academics mobilise, but it might not be. But perhaps that's predictable, because we shouldn't see academics as some sort of necessarily progressive group. They can be, can't be. Maybe we could see the university as plugged into broader changes rather than seeing it as some isolated unit on its own. So this has to be seen as a broader pushback against neoliberalism and not something that's just concerned with academics in universities. So I think any pushback there is would have to be linked up to broader campaigns for social justice that are going on in society. I don't think you can rely on academics. Some will eventually think, oh God, this is going to be bad, and mobilise, but I think a lot will just keep their head in the sand and hope that if others get sacked, they are slacker academics, and that they themselves will just get garlanded and say, look, you guys, people are great. So I think any hope there has to be more holistic, more collective. Okay, sorry for talking too long. I hope you're not all too depressed now. Questions?
Business model. think about the possibility of, as you sort of put it, like using neoliberalism against itself, in the sense of like using the cooperative model to sort of like fuck with the whole, like it has to be investing in proper businesses sort of idea, and whether we could in some ways potentially sort of use that to set up like a cooperative universities type model.
Yeah, I think that would be interesting. I have to admit, I don't know a massive amount about the Lincoln approach, which I guess might be a bit similar in some ways, although I don't think they charge fees, do they? So that wouldn't be technically non-commercial. In principle, it sounds like a really good idea, and maybe people could have a network of cooperatives, so different cooperatives, say, specialised in different areas. I think for that to work, you'd have to appeal to quite a wide age range, which would be a beneficial thing. But I started off at the Open University, and there you had a very big age range. People were there because they wanted to be there, and that created quite a nice atmosphere in classes of people being really motivated, and also taught for them 10 years later, where teaching was a fantastic experience. The classes almost taught themselves. You just guided the flow of the discussion. I think the government gives scope for that in their legislative framework. It doesn't have to just have to be about Pearson. I think for that to work, if it pulled in a broad age range, that would give it, I think, commercial scope to be successful.
To your question, James, and I think one of the things that surprised me when the fees went up was realizing that over a couple of years, then the recruitment figures picked back up again. So I was in two minds about that, because on the one hand, part of me was hoping that they wouldn't. On the other hand, part of me was hoping that people would keep going to universities. Now, is it going to happen again? And if so, what is it that makes it necessary to the students that do apply to come to university to come and get a degree? Because I can't explain this question myself. I mean, I know that statistically, it pretty much assures that you get to retain your family's earnings if you have a degree. But aside from that, I don't know what else there is. So I wonder, you know, what is it that makes it necessary for people to keep reinvesting or keep engaging with a system that's changing rapidly, but also changing for the worse?
I suspect the government might try and push the fee down a lot of Russell groups, because a lot of the mood music now is about Russell groups not offering quality for money in terms of teaching intensity. So there was a leaked document, somebody was going into number 10 and they left the document sticking out. Some of you may have seen this, and they got photographed. It's like biz don't actually know what quality is or have mechanisms, but they're trying to find a proxy for that in terms of teaching intensity, it's low, slacker professionals. So kind of wonder whether they will want to hold the fee down by saying people aren't teaching enough, use that as an excuse, and at the same time give universities the financial encouragement to start bundling out first year teaching, Pearson package, casualised staff doing it.
So I think I'm quite interested in like the way the kind of fees, the 9 grand fees, and then the kind of the green paper or white paper that we'll be seeing, kind of affects like students, because what you see is you see NUS like research has found that even in the last 5 years since the kind of introduction of 9 grand fees, that like students are going out less, so there's like less alcohol consumption, students are going out less, and like a lot of my, so I study humanities, I study English and history. And like my kind of course mates, they like calculate how much each lecture is worth if you're paying 9 grand a year, which is like pretty horrible. Because like if you miss this lecture, it costs you £50 kind of thing. And I think that one of the kind of big successes for the government in terms of like the kind of the 9 grand and the 9 grand fees is how it's changed kind of students into that kind of consumer mentality, and I think that that will continue with the introduction of something like the TEF and stuff like that, and like for example with the NSS boycott, or it's a boycott or a sabotage, it's like not necessarily decided yet whether it'll be like people encouraged to put like 100 scores for everything, or whether they'll be encouraged to boycott it altogether. There are like a lot of the arguments against it, a lot of it comes from like the post 92 universities. So the students, so sabbatical officers and students from the students' union there, they kind of see it as a way that they can still have some kind of like control over like what they're studying. So there's very much people who've like bought into this consumer mentality, even though it's like quite clearly rubbish. So I think that also there needs to be a way of introducing kind of more positive kind of collaborative approaches between academic staff and students in terms of how to approach kind of learning, because otherwise, because a lot of although the NUS has passed policy in favour of approving a boycott, because of the nature of the NUS's federalist structure, and also because of a lot of kind of discontent from other parts of kind of student, other groups of students, that actually the reality of like pushing it will very much depend on like kind of maybe providing like positive alternatives, among other things. So I suppose I was just wondering about kind of how you see that this is going to affect students with the kind of HE reforms that are coming forward.
Yeah, I don't think it would affect them directly in terms of big fee increases given the inflationary problem, but I think it will increasingly position them obviously as people, as customers, but that's going to be quite hard to engage with. I think you talk about us working more collaboratively with students, and you're absolutely right, but apart from that, a lot of academics might buy into it in different ways, but I think, you know, I just want to focus more on my ref time, so I just make it more instrumental and get in there, deliver it and get away again. I think if people have come to an education system that's instrumentalised, so leave the fee issue to one side for the moment, where it's even the case that with personal statements on UCAS forms, they're treated as model answers. So every sort of question you get, you know, why do you want to study at this university or do this subject? It's not, it should be fairly straightforward. I like this because I do, you know, that's treated as a sort of box to jump through with model answers. And I think that's the generic problem, is the instrumentalisation of education, and the fees is one strong expression of that, but it's a broader problem. I agree with what you're saying, but I can't think of an answer about how students and staff might work together more closely.
I think with fees as well, the way we kind of see kind of fees is that although in the green paper it says in line with inflation, we see that as like kind of stepping stone for the Secretary of State then having the power over rising fees, because like what Jamie was saying with the 9 grand, that people were able to kind of focus on the 9 grand kind of figure. But what you saw with like, for example, the cutting of grants in the last year is that they didn't have a day in Parliament. There wasn't time for people to go and like protest and against it, because there was the power of the Secretary of State. So we see it as kind of like, I don't know, that maybe in like 5 or 10 years time they'll move that power away from like a vote altogether and to, rather than just,
I think it was 18 MPs, wasn't it, in some of these quasi-secret committee.
That it was like by the hour being like
past that, yeah. I mean, certainly if you just keep it at 9 grand with inflation, even if it's going up only slowly, then the real cost, HE will go down. But I think you're right, but I think the government have an incentive from their perspective to keep it as low as possible and only allow a few to raise it. Possibly future, as you say, quite dramatically, but I think for the majority they will want to keep the lid on it, and they will use the teaching intensity thing, or find any means they can, make stuff up, you know, find audit data that they can then use for their cause to keep the lid down, so they can get rid of the 9 grand loan book, and focus just on a few select institutions, because their main interest is having vocational education done at the cheapest possible rate. So they think that's going to be more useful. There is a research parallel there, I think, with the possibility of keeping, this is going beyond the green paper to some of the other statements that come out from government, about having another organisation above the level of research councils that's in charge of them, and that will ultimately decide on how research money is spent, which will then push that more towards the impact agenda, and the person who has the ultimate say on that will be Chancellor of the Exchequer. Which is just to make things more depressing. Martin.
My thinking is that you think that it's like what you were saying about STEM subjects, people not being included to do kind of like humanities and English literature. I've been thinking about this thing I mentioned more like about not abstract human, you know, when I was in my first year of sociology, my research methods module, I had my session about careers and all that stuff. She said, okay, you know, the $62,000 question you're wanting to have the answer to is what kind of job am I going to get with a sociology degree? She was like, well, when you study sociology at the University of Birmingham, you learn all kinds of transferable skills. You find out how to, you know, you can demonstrate that you can organise your time, you can be punctual, you can read complicated texts, which is bollocks in my case, because I always go to the completely sculpted junior or already on that one, so I don't read the difficult, I avoid the difficult play. So like, it's demonstrating all these things, but all of those things are like general things, you know, it's like, it doesn't matter. What they were saying to me really, like, it doesn't matter if you're studying sociology. You could just as easily be doing philosophy. You could just think, no one cares if you can study. No one cares if you can quote Nietzsche. No one cares if you can, you know, quote Shakespeare. No one cares. What they care about is that you've got the manager in your head. You've internalised the manager in your head. You know, it's kind of your own self-directed manager. Thinking about in relation to this, you're saying about STEM subjects, but they don't actually, they're not really in demand any more than they were before. You were saying that, like, it's not as if there's a shortage. So is it just a purely, the thing that interests me about that is because, like, for me, a crude analysis that I would have done 3 years ago would have been like, oh, you know, they just want to shut down sociology because people are learning Marxism, they're learning dangerous ideas. But I know, because I'm in there, that most of the people in there are not Marxists. It's not exactly swimming with left-wing ideology. You know, it's pretty right-wing actually. So, you know, what is the rationale for it? If it's not about economics, really, and it's not, oh, we've got to crush sociology because it's turning everyone into a terrorist, then what is it?
Yeah, I'm not a Foucaultian, but I think in terms of it being the right type of market mentality, I mean, the thing about qualities and the thing about excellence is that they are all vacuous. So you have the Bill Redding's notion about the quality, excellence in car parking. totally in the context independent notions of skills. So you might be very good at analytic skills in sociology, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's portable. I mean, I might have analytic skills in one domain, but can't fix my car, shelves fall down. Stuff like that. So it doesn't mean to say it's a sort of universal skill, but I think behind that is to see whether you're the right type of person. And it might be the same with internships too. So you choose the right type of subject and you do an internship, not because the companies ultimately need that much free labour, the profits the corporations can be making, but because it shows you've got the face that fits. But then I can see two hands.
Yeah, thanks for your talk. I just wanted to ask you about something that you mentioned earlier. You said in the in the green paper, they said they wanted to increase BME student representation to 20%, right?
Yeah.
And the theory was that they could achieve that through private, right? I was wondering if you clarify on that a little bit. But then that got me thinking, is do they factor international students into
no.
the so-called, oh, so, okay, they don't. Okay, right, because I mean, you know, I was thinking, non-EU students, we pay more, you know, we come here, and you know, we usually pay more for a lot of other things too. And then also with the idea of a neoliberal consensus as well, like, you know, it's so, you can see that operating within the UK, but in other parts of East Asia, it is really quite pronounced and powerful, and it seemed to slot in perfectly into like the student survey of satisfaction, because if you bring students from East Asia over here who are already just psyched to be in England in the first place, then surely that would just feed into what they're trying to achieve, but seeing as they don't live, they're not counted in the BME students, then probably doesn't really
matter. I think what they're hoping is, or outcome might be, is that you have a group that the disadvantage would be geographically mobile, so one company can go in there, saturate them with marketing literature, and it's got a captive market. The marketing is really aggressive. So on the MA in Social and Political Theory a few years ago, you had someone who was at Berkeley, and he was being hammered by a for-profit. And said, you know, but I'm already doing a degree at somewhere I'm quite happy at, but it's a bang, 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 bang. And you can imagine that if you're unhappy with your 0 hours contract, or you're unemployed and you're being phoned up all the time, they say, look, just get a loan. It's proven statistically that you will massively increase your earning power. All you need to do is take out a loan. You don't have to pay it back to you, it's 21,000. And you can do a degree with us, and it won't be 9,000 like that posh snooty place down the road that wants all the A-levels for the rich kids. It will just be about $6,000 a year. But of course, the success of those type of institutions in the States has been, you know, Senator Harkin, you know, American politicians aren't necessarily left-wing, but he called them a scam. Most of them. You've got graduation rates of, say, 6 or 7%. But the federal debt stays with you. So basically, you're the conduit. So you take on the loan. That goes to the for-profit. Most of that gets spent on senior management, remuneration, and advertising. And then you pay back their salary. And that gets carried on into pensionable wages. There are people who are having their pension garnered at source by the government. So in other words, it's not... the recipe for success they hope it is. And the government actually says they expect market failure to occur in competition, but that means you could be left high and dry. They hope another company will come in and then take over, but it could be a very messy process and they might not.
Yeah, so I was just going to talk about like what the sort of maybe ask about what you think, how you view pedagogy in relation to these transformations. So like I was recently reading Nigel Tubbs, who does a lot of work on Hegel and philosophy, and I really like Hegel, I think it's very important for understanding what's going on. He talks about this notion of pleasing versus severe teaching. Pleasing being like this gratification, you know, the performance is easy to accept and it's not about the difficulty of the content, or the content itself is replaced for like a pleasing performance of that content. And the severe style is, like you were saying, the dissatisfaction. It creates difficulty and discontent. And part of the point of the severe style of teaching is that the difficulty is key to understanding the content. And what I mean by this is, if we're concerned about like human freedom generally, and I am, that's why I'm interested in sort of intellectual work, is for freedom or for communism, that entails severe teaching, or at least severe learning with people. You know, you can't be pleasing in this sense. So given that the university has become sort of a refuge for left intellectual forces, but now is quickly becoming a place where even resistance against these marketisation strategies on the left, they've even become subsumed under this pleasing category. We should find it easier to complete things, we need to get through and get our degrees, we need all these forms of support, etc., etc. I think it's becoming an untenable place for the teaching of like political freedom, or like teaching people how to be anti-authoritarian and challenge like fascism in society and so on. So what do you see as like the potential for left intellectual energies, given that the university seems to be, because this is going to be a white paper and it's going to come through and there's going to be resistance, but it's going to get railroaded through. And even if it wasn't like this, the university still might not be a good place teaching this severe style of living in terms of freedom. So where do you see the sort of do you see there's a recomposition of like left intellectual energies outside of the university or within? I mean, what do you think about?
Just on the first point about severe versus pleasing, I think it takes some changes, meaningful changes, a long process with people, with education or counselling or whatever. It is a very slow, non-linear process. The problem with having courses chopped up into termly feedback, forget the NSS, is that it assumes you just dollop in some knowledge and people like whether it's delivered or not. So if you do the severe style and say, this is actually trying to force you against yourself out of the A-level mould, people will be pissed off. But then by the time they come to see the benefit of that, might be say year three or something,
mm-hmm.
So you might have all the negative feedbacks for two courses per year. Teach, you know, over to that point, so that would be a problem because that mechanism, irrespective of the NSS, goes against that. So yes, I like that, but the problem is that it takes people a long time to recognise that the measuring of teaching quality runs counter to that. And on your question about outside the university, yes, I mean, I don't know if I'm just giving into my naturally lugubrious nature, but I'd say that I probably have quite a negative view of the university's future. In fact, I'm 46 now. I kind of think I wish I was, you know, 56, because then I'd be in closer range of early pension. I'm not actually joking. Actually, I'd like to give you a sort of neat answer to say, well, I think hope comes from those people who are more concerned about it, linking up with groups outside and seeing it's part of a broader campaign. It has to be. A lot of the academic groups have been co-opted. They think, oh, we've got FaceTime with MPs who are, but they've all been co-opted. So John Homewood was actually arguing against engaging with that, and the voices that were coming back on HAPS, it's got about 200 members, heads and professors of sociology, was I'm quoting here directly, was we were uncredible in the 70s and 80s when we were seen to be a bunch of lefty lunatics. It's taken us a long time to get professional credibility back. We don't want to spoil that by not engaging. We need to engage, and metrics are great for transparency and improving the profession. Therefore, we should be mature and engage with government in terms of metrics. That's a more extreme case against John, but others were more or less in that tenor. So I think can't rely on professional organisations, can't rely on most of the campaign groups, can't rely on a lot of academics, so it has to be part of a broader change. And as for the routine day-to-day teaching in universities, I don't know. I mean, it's not personal, but I'm getting feedback saying I was too left-wing in a first year course, and I do state that from a particular angle, but I think the problem is that people think that the media is a non-position, it's a neutral position, therefore I'm on a scale that's neutral, is off here, but actually the media is off there. So that's becoming more risky, and that's changing slowly over time. So my view of the university as a space that can remain critical is a bit pessimistic, but that might be me being not a natural optimist. But it has to be with outside groups to affect any change. Julius,
just a brief on. Thank you for your talk. Very insightful, albeit a bit depressing. Can I just ask one thing, and maybe play the devil's advocate? As far as I'm concerned, there are three options here. I mean, one is resistance. One is to develop an alternative, and the third one is probably play the impact game, as you refer to it. I'm just wondering, let's say you rule out developing an alternative, what should we not be more explicit about what the aims are of the subjects that are not that do not boost productivity? So let's say sociology as an example. What do we try to do with sociology? And what, I mean, we're not talking about the same type of impact, but surely
there must be some aim behind sociology. It's a human freedom, it's emancipation. It's about learning critical thinking. It is about learning to be dissidents. So should we not also put an effort into providing some form of justification and defense of subjects such as sociology? And what would they be?
Well, yes. I mean, that was a bit of an eye-opener, looking at the exchanges on the heads of professors of sociology, when people were saying, you know, we can't go back to the 70s and 80s of being seen as the outsider. And that's part of the problem, that if sociology, the more it tries to be accepted as a professional discipline, the more it gets co-opted and ceases to be anything useful. And you can see that already happening at institutions which say that the subject should be geared up to solving the problems of others. So the benefits of it, I mean, are massively significant, but it's how do you articulate them to a common sense that's filtered through neoliberalism? So you could say, well, it makes you see the world in a different way, the sociological imagination, like good literature and good academic work, philosophy, sociology, literature should make you do a double take on things. It should make you feel a stranger where you feel comfortable, ideally. The dissatisfaction thing. That's quite a hard idea to articulate, which is fine, because you expect that to take time to filter into people and to think it through in more detail. But that runs against the whole tenor of the education experience pre-university and the whole experience of what's valued outside university. But I wonder whether students are more useful than academics on that. But there are student groups that cut across different subjects, looking at text, sociology texts, films, literature, and seeing, that bring people in from different groups, informally, outside the teaching space, about what's of interest.
Thank you.
Miss some academic inputs, but I don't. Yeah, it'd be hard to make it core to the curriculum because then it would get instrumentalised.
Yeah. Even harder to mesh, of course.
There could be two universities. There could be the one that works as a bureaucratic enterprise and the one that, the real university that occurs in nooks and crannies with people that are really interested in stuff.
Mm-hmm. Sorry if this is a slightly dim question to ask, but what do you mean by the prison industrial complex?
The fact in the States, when it was decided decades ago that drugs were to be demonised, basically allowed the state then to be really heavy-handed with groups it didn't like. And now the incarceration rate for African Americans is colossal, so basically are privatised prisons, and the police force are just disproportionately targeting certain groups, pump them into the privatised prisons, and those privatised prisons are making quite a nice profit. So they're keeping a group down and just using them as capital. So the federal money, state money, public money is being used to keep the private sector going. And one of the more egregious cases of that was a judge on a juvenile court, and this is a more egregious case, was whenever teenagers came before him for mild problems, like a bit of graffiti or something, it's like, prison, and they're all getting sent off to this prison. And who was one of the shareholders in that prison? Oh, it was the judge. Basically, it's that, you swore at your mother, oh, that's 2 months in prison. It was on Michael Moore's program, I think it was Capitalism and Love Story. But basically, they're there to make profits. You have demonized communities, the state then just oppresses them, uses the war on drugs as an excuse, pushes vast numbers of them into incarceration, and those companies make profits. So in some towns where they maybe had a factory go, the employer is now the prison. So you get towns, economies based on prisons. That will then pay the minimum amount of money. There's another problem here too, that in London, the starting salary for a prison officer is 19,000. they'd be hard enough to live on a lot of places, but in London, that's ludicrous. They say, oh, the prisons are in chaos. There's drugs coming in left, right and centre, with drones being flown in with them, but the starting salary for prison officers is 19,000. So the possibility of getting good committed staff is minimal, even lower in the States. In the States also, there's some police forces where they got rid of pension benefits too. So you've got a police force that are incentivised, you know, not saying they're corrupt, but it's a border police force, some of the border police forces with Mexico, the police are on, they've had pay cuts and they've lost their pension and healthcare, the privatised healthcare system.
Firstly, what you were saying about the severe style and also the response to the question I asked earlier. I mean, I think if we look at the United States, supposedly the most excellent university system in the world, also the most unequal, like you said, graduation rates in some of the universities there look a lot like the ones that are going to be set up in this country, 6%. It's very low, right? Now, I think that I'm happy to hear that John Holmwood said, let's not participate in all these consultations, otherwise we legitimize it, because that's the kind of style that I'm thinking needs to actually, that's the approach that I think we need to take, we need to start taking. Because, as I see it, I mean, the justification for the existence of the university as it is now is still the fact that we have a class society, and the only way to live with that is to have social mobility. And the number one easiest way for people who are younger or people who are in jobs and want to seek better pay progression, the number one easier way to do that is to go seek an education, no matter what the cost. Now, I think, Martin, you're right. You do take a risk. That's the risk of upward or downward social mobility, right? It could go either way. Usually goes up, but it can go down. And essentially, you're just going through a process where you're being reclassed, and you don't know how you're going to be reclassed. But I think we have to be, I mean, I have some students, and I think I'm frank with them. And they're in two minds about whether they like me or not, I suppose. But what's important is that they know what's coming, and it's important that when they get out, they're able to draw the line between it was my tutors who put me in this situation, or it was the system that put me in this situation. They might not be so satisfied with the student experience. They're certainly satisfied with the grades they're getting. They're certainly satisfied with the help they're receiving. They're certainly satisfied that they know where they stand. So you didn't do this. They did this, right? And so it's important to point the finger upward. Otherwise, we'll just start pointing at each other too much, as we have been doing for a while.
Yeah. So you mean you're like, are you like blaming the system instead of individuals then?
Yeah.
I have like, I've been trying not to say it through a bit, so I'm going to finish up the chat, but like, something that like really strikes me every time that I have these sort of conversations and think about the Green Paper, like I graduated a couple of years ago, and then since then I've been working in like the third sector, and there are like incredible similarities to the way that the third sector NGOs work and the way that universities are going to work, in the sense that like everything that I do is based on grant funding, which is comes from central government ultimately through mediated random other shit, and the sort of goals that you're meant to be doing, that the auditing is the same. The way that you get a grant is through like very specific, like meet specific criteria, and having like keywords that you get good at. You get good at the business of writing the grant bit that's gonna fit in with this specific audit. And because of that, public sector services are being completely decimated of any like good content. Everything is short term, everything is like, oh look, this is the beginning and the end of that project. Did people get was employability improved? This social participation was like, you know, how many people from this cultural background compared to this cultural background came in a very sort of like cynical way, and any sort of like long term. there's no way to fund and host like mine, which is like community worker, and to have someone consistently involved in people's lives in a way that would actually socially impact them, because there's no way to sort of like to measure it, whereas there is a way to sort of measure, like, we did X number of projects, we surveyed these people, that sort of thing. And I think in a lot of ways, I see like them running parallel with the education system in lots of ways. I'd be quite interested in like doing that comparison, but I feel like I don't know enough about the education side of things. But it's been quite useful coming here and seeing that. But I think there's like a lot of interesting comparisons to be made in the
functions. The word that comes to mind then is unbundling, because you've got unbundling state sector activities and passing them on to third sectors, and then saying, well, here's, you know, dance this tune, I'll dance to our tune to get the money, and if you don't, oops, it's
yes.
over. Oh, and by the way, here's a clause that makes you, means that you can't criticise us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even if you dare.
Well, yeah, charities
yeah.
can't do anything, they're completely
I think there'll be a similar sort of unbundling where first, second year teaching is perhaps done on a casualised basis by Pearson products and MOOCs with casual staff, and then research teams will be doing the impact research and maybe teaching graduates and third years. But that'll be on short, they might be on temporary contracts, not necessarily long term contracts. But you have this sort of general fragment, nothing, no jobs for life.
Yes.
So in the third sector, rather than have someone job for life in the public sector, get rid of the public sector, put it out to the third sector, it's contingent upon each grant and doing what the funder wants.
Mm-hmm.
Here,
yeah.
it's contingent upon customers buying that Pearson product that you provide, or you being able to be a part of a team that gets an impact grant. But
yeah, sorry, I was like,
you
know, I'm trying to put hands up, but I'm sort of sitting on the edge of my seat, wanting to contribute. It's like, it's so frustrating. I mean, I think this does go beyond education, and someone who spoke at the conference for me in February, CEO of something called Gateway Family Services, I don't know if that was related to your charity, but they did something very similar. It was about getting mostly women employable, upskilling them, getting them into jobs, and essentially kind of funding them in that position, paying for the training, and then they'd be in a sustainable position to contribute. And it's like austerity is like almost a new phase in kind of neoliberalism and new public management, because in the past it was all about KPIs, but now it's more and more about, when Gateway lost their funding because they couldn't demonstrate that they could provide a financial return on the grant money they were getting from the local authority. Very short term, very localised.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, yeah, it's frustrating, because you know, the student movement post 68, you ask that question about how do we spend our intellectual energies and what do we do, there's been no question that it has to be revolutionary, it has to be like transcend the campus, has to be, you know, intersectional in the sense that you're bringing people from different struggles together to fight for systemic change as opposed to localized change. I don't know, I just find it just frustrating that we can talk so hopelessly about, oh, well, you know, we can kind of do these localized acts of resistance, but they won't work, and we know they won't work. And, you know, we use this Foucauldian language of resistance, and we forget that Foucault wasn't recommending individualized, localized acts of resistance. Was describing that as part of the strength of the neoliberal model, or, you know, the way we internalise these things. So yeah, I think there needs to be more ambition, I think, in our activism and our organising as well. You know, you have to organise if you want to change things. You know, you can't just not, you know, just, I think we should organise around a survey for sure, but, you know.
I do wonder if the technological change is coming, you know, about AI knocking out 48% of jobs, whether. But if you just do the right degree, the AI designer, then you'll have a job. But I mean, I could talk about a post-capitalist economy, which could go in a good direction or a very not good direction, which is not that far off. You know,
they're talking about AI replacing vast numbers of jobs in 10, 15 years. But you're right, I mean, we have academics have to overcome sort of academic hermetic outlook of just their department, or their discipline, or their university. And think of it as a much broader campaign against injustice, capitalism.